Let's go to Seattle, Washington, where comedian Mike Recine is standing by. You've seen him on Conan. You've seen his special on Comedy Central. And you should all listen to The Sit Down, his podcast on organized crime, which will be taping a live episode at the Philadelphia Punchline on October 24th. Thank you for joining us, Mike Recine.
Thanks for having me.
Why organized crime?
I don't know. I guess I feel like, you know, I wanted to do a podcast. I think it's a good way to connect with people. And I felt like maybe, you know, something needed a, like it needed some kind of hook. So I was like, you know, I'm from Jersey. I like talking about this stuff. I know a little bit about the mob. So we started off just talking about different figures in the mob. And then like, then we started going into other stuff. Like, so really we'll talk about anything that's sort of like two people doing a crime together. We'll do that. So we did an episode. We wanted to do an episode about the housing crisis. And then we recently did an episode about, the Saudis and, I'm trying to think of the other ones that we've done recently.
So all those things are extensions of organized crime. Usually when we think of organized crime, we think of the Italian mafia. We've learned that there's more to organized crime than the five families.
Yeah, and I think that got a little boring after a while because it was kind of like the same stories over and over again. So now we'll just kind of do whatever.
Now, you grew up in Jersey. I'm from Jersey. Where in Jersey are you?
Oh, okay. I'm from Hamilton, near Trenton and Princeton.
Okay, I'm from Englewood, about seven miles away from where Hamilton got popped by Aaron Burr.
Yeah. Nice. So I went to Montclair State, so Sopranos country.
How many times have you seen each episode of The Sopranos?
I think probably I'm rewatching it for the second time now with my girlfriend, so she's getting to see it for the first time, which is pretty fun.
So you've only seen The Sopranos once?
Yeah.
That's, well,
I should have lied, right? Yeah.
I've over and over and over again to the point where I don't watch anything. If I'm going to watch television, I go, I could watch Game of Thrones. Why don't I watch the one about Uncle June getting caught going down on a girl? That's more interesting to me.
Oh, yeah. That was very embarrassing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Such a great show because, like, if you're the kind of guy who, like, believes it's wrong to go down on a woman, you'll enjoy that show. And then if you see what they're making fun of, you'll enjoy the show too. So it's like, I just love how it's for like smart people and dumb people.
So you must have a fascination with organized crime. Were you ever tempted to lead a life of crime?
No, I mean, I worked for a garbage company a couple years ago and I...
Waste management.
Sometimes, yeah. Well, it was, I mean, that sounds cooler than it was. I worked for 1-800-GOT-JUNK, which is like, who even, but
I called the wrong number. I called Got Junk and some guy came over with a large cock. So it was a complete bad joke.
Yeah. No, but I did that. And like, you know, every once in a while you're like, if you pay cash, we can give you a little discount. And you call the office and like say that they canceled the job. But I think that's kind of like the extent of. Oh, and then sometimes like when I'm at Home Depot, when you go to the self-checkout, if the thing doesn't scan, I just throw it in the bag.
Nobody you do?
Care. Yeah. It's pretty easy to, yeah.
And don't you feel guilty?
I guess a little bit, yeah.
Were you raised in a family that discouraged that kind of stuff? I would assume you.
I'm from a very like Cusimano family.
The Cusimanos who are next door to the Sopranos. Dr. Cusimano.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Wonder Bread Wops they're called.
Are you Italian?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm five. My dad's all Italian. My mom's a quarter Italian.
And they must be upset about the stereotypes. There was a guy named, I believe his name was Columbo, who started the Italian Anti-Defamation League. He was sick and tired of Italians being portrayed as mobsters. And he ended up getting gunned down at one of his rallies because he was a mobster.
Well, it's kind of like, I mean, I get it, but what else are you gonna portray us as, you know? What's like interest? I don't know.
How many Italians treat the mafia the way non-Italians treat the CIA? Like most guys, if they're trying to break up with a woman or scare somebody, if they're not Italian, they let off hints that they're with the CIA. Do you ever pretend that because you're Italian, you're mobbed up just to get things?
No, I wish I could, but maybe that's why I'm so interested in it, because it was always I never had any connection to it. And maybe that's why I was able to I was able to be sort of like a fan of that kind of stuff.
What would happen if I entered your world and you heard that I was mobbed up? You just heard there was a rumor spread that, you know what? Don't mess with David Feldman. He's mobbed up. Would you respect me? Would you give me things?
I guess I would, but it's really like they don't really have a ton of power anymore. I don't know what they're even doing or up to. Yeah, I don't know. That's an interesting point, because I feel like it would be funny to write like a TV show about the mob now and kind of where they're at, and see if anybody even like takes them seriously, you know?
Yeah, I think we like to think that Giuliani, when he was a U.S. attorney under Reagan, got rid of the mob. But you know what I think?
What?
I think the mob is very much alive, but they just graduated to the next generation and went off to Ivy League schools and are working at Chase and Goldman Sachs, and their fingernails are much cleaner now.
I think so. I mean, that's kind of the funny thing about it, where it's like you look at the history of it, and a lot of these people were just sort of like poor working class immigrants, and that was a way for them to sort of like enter the get into like the upper class, you know? Because it's like, what else were they going to do?
Isn't the Trump family organized crime in a very blatant way? They're just not Italian.
Yeah, I think so. The Kushners too.
Yeah.
We want to do a we want to do a deep dive on them.
The guy hasn't paid any taxes. There was just a story in the New York Times about Kushner not paying any taxes. Bag of Cheetos?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I have a bottle of water, and it's frozen. There's ice in it.
And you're in beautiful Seattle,
Sorry.
and you do a live version of your podcast. What is that like? Does the audience ask questions? What kind of guests do you have?
We're doing the first one in Philadelphia this Wednesday at the Philly Punchline. So we'll see how it goes. We'll have some Philly comics on, and we'll talk about Philly organized crime and see
Nikki
how it goes.
Scarfo?
Nikki Scarfo, and yeah, so we did like a 3-part episode on him with Mike Vecchione.
Who was Nikki Scarfo?
Nikki Scarfo was the boss of the Philadelphia family. Yeah, he had a very brutal, very violent reign as boss.
He just died, right?
He died. Yeah, he died in 2017 in prison. But yeah, he was like a little guy. Like, usually the point, the like the goal is to kind of like stay away from violence and stuff, but he like enjoyed it. He liked to murder people.
As long as you're not hurting anybody. Do any of these guys not go to prison and live happily ever after? Wasn't there one guy,
There's a
Bonanno?
few.
Didn't Bonanno live happily ever after?
Joe Bonanno did, and then yeah, Frank Costello retired. He was able to retire. I think Vincent the Chin Gigante tried to kill him, and then it like the bullet like grazed his ear,
Try to
and then
kill
in
who?
court tried to kill Frank Costello.
Ah.
Yeah, because Costello was the boss of the Genovese family, which was Lucky Luciano's family.
And Vincent the Chin tried to present himself as senile, right? He would walk
Yeah,
around in
in a
his pajamas.
bathrobe, just pissing on the street. Yeah, which is, yeah, kind of
Genius.
brilliant. Yeah, Yeah.
Who's your favorite mobster?
My favorite mobster is man, I don't know. I like I guess I like Gaspipe. He's pretty cool. Because I like Gaspipe because he's like committed to the lifestyle.
Who's Gaspipe? I have no idea who he is.
He was the underboss of the Lucchese family. He was like one of John Gotti's like enemies. But he was pretty violent too. And he wasn't a guy that like I guess he wasn't a guy that like needed to be liked, you know? And I kind of respect that about him. Because you look at a lot of these guys, like they really like you would think someone who's like a criminal who like leads a life of crime would just like not care what people think about them. But all these guys, like they desperately want to like write books and consult on movies and be in movies. And it's like, they love the attention.
And what do they do all day? Cause they don't really murder once a year at most. Right. And it's a big thing to commit a murder, right?
It's a big thing. Yeah.
So what do they do all day?
One thing that a couple of my friends have pointed out, they kind of live like podcasters, you know. They have their clubhouse. It's
like... Only here's the difference: people listen to them.
Yeah,
when they speak.
Right.
Go ahead.
Right.
Yeah.
But I tried to do a bit about that. I was like, wouldn't it be great if you could like live like the mafia, but not have to kill anybody? Like, you just get to like sit in front of a pork store all day with your friends and like drink espresso and wear velour tracksuits. I mean, it's kind of great if you take away the, you know, the criminal aspect of it.
Is it an easy life? The myth is that they're constantly looking around the corner. Somebody's going to shoot them. Mm-hmm. They got to be willing to fight and go on the lam.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? Do you think it's mostly easy?
I think it's got to be easier than being like a factory worker or something. You know, I'm sure it's stressful. But there was that Sopranos episode, the Columbus Day episode, where they're like, yeah, what do we ever get? We'd have to work our balls off for. But really, when you think about it, like how hard do they really work? Every shot is them, you know, in a lawn chair at a construction site or whatever.
Do they end up with any money? Do you think the children, like Gotti's kids...
Yeah.
Ended up doing reality television. You would think he put a little money away. Or maybe Gotti wasn't really running the Gambino family. Maybe he was just the front man.
You would think that he buried it somewhere or something.
Is it easy to hide money? How much have you hidden? How much have you hidden from the government?
You mean from my wife?
Yeah.
I don't know. I have some money in my in my top drawer, but I don't know. I don't know how I would do it if I had to hide large sums of money. Cause I feel like you forget where it is, you know,
mm-hmm.
You bury it or, I mean, how would you hide it?
The Paul Manafort trial was a great lesson in money laundering. I never really understood how money laundering worked. And I paid attention to Paul Manafort. I thought, oh, okay. That's how it's done. I kind of knew that I was working for certain club owners or mm-hmm. certain producers, and they were laundering money. You could tell that they weren't paying attention.
And usually 9 times out of 10, when someone starts like a podcast network, I mean, that's a pretty good indicator that they're laundering money.
Really?
Yeah. There was a company called Breakthrough Radio, I think a few years ago. And, it was like the first podcast network. I think this is maybe like 7 years ago. And then I think I found out that it was just a money laundering scheme.
Where would the East Coast be without money laundering?
I'm
utterly convinced that unless you're laundering money on the East Coast, no way to make a living unless you're laundering money. All real estate is money laundering.
Mm-hmm. But I want to say, too, the funny thing about like obtaining large sums of money illegally is that it's all, you know, it's cash. So like you can't account for the money. So like what do you end up buying besides like $17,000 ostrich jackets when you're 64 years old? You know, like there's only so much you can buy with a briefcase full of cash.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like furniture. I guess like you get a nice mirror. You can go to restaurants, but you can't really buy anything big with, you know.
Well, the way Manafort did it was genius.
Mm-hmm.
if I understood it properly, and you and I should try this, he set up an LLC in Cyprus without his name on it. So he put all the Ukrainian money into the LLC, which was headquartered in Cyprus, right? And then he as Paul Manafort, borrowed millions of dollars from this LLC.
Okay.
It shows up as a loan. The IRS says, oh, he owes money to this LLC. They didn't know he owned the LLC.
Okay.
And he's just paying himself back. And it, so he's moving all that money into America. Kind of interesting. How do we do that? Because I would like to do that.
Yeah, I have no idea. Maybe a Patreon? Maybe you get people to like...
Why don't we set up a Patreon account as a money laundering operation?
The FBI listens to your show. They're like, there's no way people are paying money for this garbage. they're just talking about their dicks for an hour and a half.
Right. I keep thinking I can figure it out. I keep thinking I can figure out a way to make a killing somehow in some kind of business. But in America... I really am convinced that unless you're willing to launder money for the Yakuza, it isn't going to happen. You can't compete.
Yeah.
If you're honest, you can't compete with people who are secretly laundering money.
Right. I know. Is there anything about Paul Manafort that you look at him, you go, I kind of respect that guy. You know, he didn't roll over on anybody. Unlike Michael Cohen, that rat.
Right.
That rat bastard.
Right. Who's now a Democrat.
Yeah.
How can you be a Democrat if you stand up to Trump? He's not a real Democrat. I think Manafort finally flipped, didn't he?
I think so, yeah.
So you're in Seattle with your brother and your father.
Yeah, my mom wanted my father out of the house, and she was like, let me buy you guys tickets to Seattle. So
and what are you doing in Seattle? What are you doing in Seattle?
Just hanging out. We're eating. My dad likes to eat, so just, you know.
And but, that's fantastic. The three of you, and you're married, right?
Not yet, but you know, probably soon. I live with my girlfriend. We have two dogs, so she kind of forced this dog on me, and I can't. You know, it's like I can't leave. So I'll do it eventually.
What kind of dogs?
One's a Yorkie. He's 11, and the other one's a Shar Pei pug puppy. He's very cute. He's 9 months.
That's heaven.
He's got a nice little Instagram following. So that's another way you could launder money. You get a puppy and you have an Instagram account and you go, it's from people who think my dog is cute.
And does he sleep in the bed with you?
Yeah, he does. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a little baby. And how's the older dog with the baby?
He's good. The older dog barks a lot, and the younger dog loves like meeting other dogs on the street. So the older dog will bark at dogs on the street, and then the younger dog gets mad at him, like he's scaring his friends away.
Who's the alpha?
Probably, I think Oliver's kind of like Oliver's a Yorkie. He's kind of like the quiet. He's like the chin gigante of the, you know, of the operation. He's because he just got 19 teeth removed, so he's like this old, you know. Old guy pretending he's senile, but he's like pulling all the strings.
19 teeth?
Yeah. I didn't even know he had 19 teeth.
No doggy dentures?
No doggy dentures.
So you're traveling with your dad and your brother. Does your dad have the same politics as you, or is this turned into a big screaming match?
Yeah, a little bit. You know, my dad's pretty conservative, and like, you know, him and my brother sort of got into an argument today about economics, and it was very boring, and I was like, all right, I gotta go, you know, do a podcast. But funny, they were talking about like, and I don't even know that much about this, but they were talking about like, you know, Reagan and tax policy and stuff like that. And I don't know, I almost feel like, because I think we're probably on the same side of the political spectrum, and all this stuff about like discourse and hearing the other side is like a little bit of a trap, you know? And I just feel like you have to kind of like figure out where you stand on stuff and just and vote. And you don't always have to like debate Ben Shapiro, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they live for that.
Yeah.
Whenever things go well for Trump, I get calls from Republicans who want to talk to me. because things went well for Trump, but they didn't go well for that Republican friend of mine. So he wants to call me and gloat because that's the only reason he voted for Trump. It was to upset me. It was to get me worked up. That's all they stand for is
to trigger the libs.
To trigger the libs, to make us feel stupid, to make us feel played. So if you don't take the bait, you're hurting them. Just stay out of the argument.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's the other thing too. I mean, we were talking about like people in the mob who like want to be accepted. Like everybody wants to, I don't know, nobody wants to feel like left out of stuff, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like they can like, I feel like they always complain that like the media is so liberal and stuff, but like if they got invited to an SNL after party, they would be there, you know? Mm-hmm. So
how is the media liberal? Noam Chomsky is never on.
Yeah.
It's not a liberal media. They don't, they'll discuss Russia because that falls under the purview of the political food fight.
Right.
But they really aren't going to go full blown liberal.
Right.
So you were raised.
I was watching.
Go ahead.
Well, so I was watching CNN a couple weeks ago, and like, just when you watch the commercials, like you can kind of tell what you're watching. Like there was some commercial where they were like waiting for a liver transplant can be really hard, and they show like a shot of like people waiting in line, and they're like, but you know, with, and I forget what the company was or whatever, but like the commercial was like people in line being like pulled out of line to like get their liver. So like, I guess that's who's paying for this show to be on. And then, I don't know. So once you kind of like one thing I sort of like to get my news from a little more like independent media stuff. I like to watch Majority Report and certain podcasts.
He's the best.
Stuff like
I love Sam Cedar. He's the best.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So where do you get your news from?
I like, there's a podcast called Chapo Trap House that I like
a
lot. And then Majority Report. I mean, those are the big two. And then mostly podcasts. And then I'll read, you know, I read whenever I can. But also I'm like kind of busy, you know.
Traveling, doing stand-up. Yeah. How long have you been doing stand-up?
12 years.
And where'd you start?
In Jersey, at another money laundering venture, Rascals Comedy Club.
In East Orange?
In Montclair.
We don't know if that's not a money. That's what they've been making.
I think all the Rascals got shut down, though.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, maybe it was.
I don't
want to get hurt.
Yeah.
I don't want to be hurt by anybody.
That's fine.
And you started 12 years ago.
Yeah. Isn't it funny how no one makes money in this, though? It seems like.
Who doesn't make money?
Well, it just seems like every comedy club is a money laundering front. You know, what I'm thinking of doing is I'm going to adopt a kid and just teach him how to be an Instagram star. I'll teach him how to like tap dance or something. And then maybe we'll get DiGiorno to sponsor us.
When did you get funny?
I don't know. I did some bringer shows and open mics and stuff in college. And then I dropped out of college. I didn't want to be there. I moved to New York when I was 20. So in 2007, and, just did open mics and bar shows and got passed at clubs. And, you know, had a couple of writing jobs here and there and worked the road. And I did Conan in 2014. That was my first late night. And then 2 years later I did the half hour and another Conan, I'm right back to where I was. I'm thinking about changing my name and starting over again. You
know? Is everybody a comic now?
It seems like it, but also it seems like, cause you've probably been doing this longer than I have, but it does go through these cycles where it's like stand up comedy is like everybody hates it and then everybody is doing it. So hopefully we'll go through another cycle of like everyone hating it and it not being respected as an art form. And then when it comes back, you know, who knows?
I don't think it's going to go away this time because I think it's become so personal.
Mm-hmm.
It's now less about jokes and more about biography.
Yeah.
That has legs, I think.
I just remember in like 2008, I was like doing this open mic, and this like good looking couple like walked by the bar, and this girl goes, "Ooh, it's stand up comedy in there," and she like makes this face, and they keep walking.
Yeah.
And I, but now it's like, yeah, now somebody, one of my friends said recently, it's like an extension of a liberal arts degree, stand up.
When I did it,
Yeah.
the idea of standing up, I got up at Dangerfields at 3 in the morning, nervous stomach. I was terrified. I didn't think I'd be able to do it. People said to me when I did do it, "I can't believe you did it. Where'd you get the balls?" Is it still a big thing for somebody to get up and do stand up? I'm not talking about succeeding at it, just to do an open mic and get up and talk and tell jokes in front of an audience. Do people still have the stage fright that existed back when I started?
I think probably. I mean, people will still say to me after a bad set, they'll be like, "Hey, it takes courage to get up there, you know?"
That act. That's what I get.
Yeah.
It takes courage to be you.
I couldn't get up there. Yeah.
Yeah. What's the worst bomb you've ever had?
So I did a show at a country club back in like 2011, and it was funny because like we got there and it was like four comics. Do you know Dan Soder?
Yeah.
So Dan Soder was there. It was me, Dan Soder, Ophira Eisenberg, and Sean Donnelly was
They've all done this
hosting.
show. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, cool. So Sean was hosting. So we get there and like we're at the bar and we hear some lady be like, "Who are these?" We were like, "Who are these people wearing jeans?" But then we realized they're the comedians. And then so we're kind of like nervous and we're like, "Ah, they're gonna hate." We're like joking before the show. We're like, "Ah, they're gonna hate us and everything." But Sean Donnelly gets up there and he goes, "Hey, how you doing, you rich old fucks?" And they like laughed. So, and I think I was probably like 24 at the time. So I hear that and I'm like, "Oh, this is good. These people have like a sense of humor about themselves, you know?" So I get up and I'm like, "Hey, everybody, how about a hand for the wait staff? You know, those people that you don't look in the face when they're serving you." I'm like, "Doesn't the roast beef taste better when you get to yell at the guy who made it?" And the whole room just went silent, and some guy in the front row goes, "No." And then I did 15 minutes of without a single laugh. And then a lady even got up. This lady got up and tried to leave, and she had a cane. And I was like, "Oh, good, I'm walking someone who like can't even walk."
You're limping an audience
Yeah.
member.
Yeah. I walked a handicapped person.
Yeah. I've always wanted to play country clubs. I always wish I could have been that kind of like cruise ship comic, a bland, just a mediocre guy who doesn't offend
Yeah.
and just collects a check and goes home and
'Cause you always wonder like what goes on in the minds of those guys. Like, do they think that they're like great? They must
no, they
or
don't. And I say
yeah.
to them, "You got it made.
Yeah.
You're playing cruise ships. You're doing the condo circuit. You're doing colleges. You don't
Yeah.
offend anybody. You got it made." "Yeah, but nobody takes me seriously." "Well, you're a comic. You're
Yeah.
not supposed to be taken seriously." "Yeah, but I want respect." "You're a comic. You don't need respect. You're making
Yeah.
money and you're not offending anybody." I'd give anything to be able to make an audience laugh without having to make them also hate me. I don't know
Yeah.
how to make an audience laugh without them feeling dirty and disgusting.
Yeah, that's kind of like the tough thing too, where it's like you get up and you're doing bits that you like, but you know that they're making someone like feel bad. 'Cause they're taking you seriously or they think you
I
mean what you're
know.
saying. It's just such a weird, yeah. But what's it like for you, like at this point in your career, are you still doing stand up a lot, or is it something you don't do as
Yeah, but I'm
much, or
not
like that?
famous. So the
Yeah.
problem is,
Yeah.
I get up and they don't know me.
Yeah.
They look at a guy and they think, "Well, this old guy's up there. He's not famous. This is pathetic."
Yeah.
And so I have learned to, drive into the skid. My whole bit now is talking about my living with my mother. And I just make
Yeah.
it so depressing about sharing a bathroom with my mother in an
Nice.
apartment in Brooklyn, which some people are actually doing. sharing an apartment with my mother. I don't mean to make fun of anybody who has to live with their mother, but
no, but those people have it made. Sometimes you meet people in the city, they're like, oh yeah, I just live at home, and you know, my family has a building in Queens.
Mm-hmm.
And they just get free rent, you know.
Yeah, but I mean I try to make it as depressing as I can.
Yeah, yeah,
you know,
good.
That I'm, you know, divorced, broke, mm-hmm. and living with my mom in a in a studio apartment in Brooklyn. I just like to paint the most horrific picture, and the audience believes it, and I get angry that they're believing it, and then they're laughing at me, not with me. And I think mm-hmm. of some friends of mine who are doing the cruise ships in the condo circuit, talking mm-hmm. about nothing, and mm-hmm. I think that's the answer.
Yeah.
They're making money, you know, they're getting free meals on the cruise ship, and I'm trying mm-hmm. to do what? Torture myself.
Yeah, you'll hear stories, too, about people who, like, end up opening for someone super famous, and they, you know, they, like, they have this gig that they kind of fell into, and they make, like, $500,000 a year just being whatever, like, George Lopez's opener or whatever, right. And then they're miserable because they're like, yeah, I never got to where I could have, you know?
When you open for a big name, 15 minutes away from superstardom, you're
but it never really, yeah.
You get to taste it, smell it, and hear it, but it's not you.
Because I open for Colin Jost sometimes from SNL,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then it's like, yeah, it's fun opening for him, but then I have to like find him underage whores.
Find him under what?
Underage. I have to find him underage women to have sex with.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You want me to take that out?
No.
Isn't he dating Scarlett Johansson?
Yeah. Yeah.
He doesn't need underage tours.
No. Yeah.
So everybody should go see Mike Recine at the Philadelphia Punchline October 24th. See him tape an episode of The Sit Down. It's a great podcast about organized crime. Will you come back?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Okay, stay on the line for 1 second, sir. Oh, how do people great. Follow you on Twitter?
I'm on Twitter at Mike Recine, and then Instagram Recine Mike, and then my website MikeRecine.com is all my road dates.
Spell Recine.
R-E-C-I-N-E.
Perfect. Stay on the line for 1 second.